The first industrial revolution, which is generally dated as starting in 1760, ushered in a new era in economic history. A series of technologies transformed the production process in key industries, and these innovations paved the way for sustained economic growth. But these structural changes also had costs. The rise of industrial manufacturing was fueled by increased coal consumption and resulted in unprecedented levels of air pollution. Did the spatial distribution of this pollution affect the layout of industrial cities? In England, this was a period of rapid urbanization as workers migrated from the countryside, and industrial pollution may have shaped the evolving urban landscape in persistent ways. Indeed, an interesting regularity is that formerly industrial cities tend to have eastern suburbs today that are notably poorer than their western suburbs. Is this a long-lived remnant of 19th century pollution? To answer this question, the authors combined data on neighborhood characteristics over 200 years with a novel method for modeling historical pollution. Using detailed ordnance survey maps published between 1880 and 1900, they geolocate industrial chimneys in the 70 largest metropolitan areas in England. Average emissions from each chimney are estimated using industry-level statistics, and this produces a map of pollution sources. To then track where this pollution traveled once it was released, they use the ADMS-5 dispersion model. The ADMS-5 models atmospheric dispersion given a number of inputs, including characteristics of the emission source, topographical features of the surrounding terrain, and, crucially, wind direction and intensity. This figure shows the wind data used to model dispersion in northern and southern England, and shows that winds blow primarily from the west-southwest direction. Thus, the idea is to model the distribution of pollution emitted over the 1880 to 1900 period, and to investigate its short and long-run impact on affected neighborhoods. These figures provide an initial look. On the left is the estimated spatial gradient of pollution, averaged across cities, and with warmer colors indicating higher values. Relative to the city centroid, pollution is more concentrated to the east. On the right, we see a similar gradient. Eastern neighborhoods also have a high share of low-skilled workers, as measured in 1881. This suggests a link between pollution and neighborhood sorting, but there could be other explanations. Pollution is a function of both atmospheric dispersion and the location of industrial chimneys, and neighborhoods located close to chimneys tend to have a higher share of low-skilled workers. This likely reflects a number of factors unrelated to pollution, including that commuting costs are lower for factory workers in these areas. Digging deeper, however, reveals an interesting pattern. If we condition on distance to pollution sources and amenities, there is an excess share of low-skilled workers in neighborhoods located to the northeast of industrial chimneys. In other words, among neighborhoods located the same distance from a chimney, those that happen to lie in the path of prevailing winds, and who are therefore more exposed to pollution blown through the air, have a higher share of low-skilled workers. To examine this more robustly, the authors estimate the relationship between pollution and neighborhood composition after controlling for a long list of neighborhood factors, including geographic features and distance from amenities and industries. And they find a strong positive relationship. A pollution differential equivalent to that between the 10th and 90th percentile in Manchester is associated with a 16 percentage point difference in the share of low-skilled workers. Reassuringly, there is no correlation between pollution in 1880 to 1900 and the share of low-skilled workers in 1817, which predates the rise in coal use. To emphasize the role of prevailing winds in driving these results, this figure shows that if we control for neighborhood distance from pollution sources, there is excess deprivation in neighborhoods lying just in a narrow corridor downwind of industrial chimneys. Again, no such pattern exists if we look at neighborhood composition in 1817. Thus, pollution during the Industrial Revolution had a marked impact on residential sorting. As air pollution became a major environmental disamenity, the lower classes were left in more polluted neighborhoods. What about the long-run impact? Remarkably, while there has been some reversion to the mean, these spatial inequalities have largely persisted up to the present day. The same 10th to 90th percentile difference in historical pollution explains a 16 percentage point gradient in neighborhood composition in 2011 and a 40% difference in property prices. These results are especially surprising given that, in line with changes in coal consumption, industrial pollution in England slowed during the 20th century and largely stopped with the passage of the Second Clean Air Act in 1968. Well after the original pollution differentials had dissipated, the effects of neighborhood sorting have remained entrenched. Simulations from a quantitative model indicate that in the most polluted cities, historical pollution increased present-day neighborhood segregation by about one standard deviation. In sum, this paper reveals the historical underpinnings of a contemporary observation. The east sides of formerly industrial cities tend to be more deprived, and this is partially a remnant of atmospheric pollution during the Industrial Revolution. These results demonstrate that temporary periods of heavy pollution can give rise to long-lasting spatial inequities, an insight that is highly relevant for developing countries that are industrializing today. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. These include papers studying pollution and neighborhood sorting in modern settings, research on residential segregation, and, relatedly, work on the dynamics of gentrification.